Let's move now to the panel, and may I call on the first speaker, Alexandre de Germay, who is Senior Vice President, Global Head of Cardiovascular and Established Products at Sanofi.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for the opportunity to contribute to this roundtable. I think we all recognize, it's been well said previously, that the pandemic has put extraordinary pressure on the healthcare system around the world. Most healthcare systems were already stretched thin before the pandemic, and now they've been pushed to near breaking points in many parts of the world. COVID-19, as our chairman said in the opening, affirmed the highly importance of health as a macro priority. It highlights also the need to significantly increase our investments to bring those healthcare systems to the next level. As pharmaceutical company, we have of course an essential role to play in bringing solutions to address the immediate crisis. And obviously, I can tell you that we were under incredible pressure at the first lockdown to ensure that our essential medicine, in particular for the intensive care units, were actually available around the world in all the hospitals, because we had, of course, surge demand, unpredictable demand, of course, but also a very complex supply chain, as you can imagine, with different parts of our components coming from all over the world. So that was our priority. I think the industry in general step up to the task and delivered, I think, a continuous supply during those time of pressure. But at the same time, I think the pharmaceutical industry in general can contribute to strengthen our healthcare system. And in that context, I'd like to share with you three areas of consideration. The first one, I think it was very well actually introduced by Professor Flau when he talks about the chronic diseases. Most healthcare systems today are set as sick care system, where the intervention happens only when the person gets sick, versus a true healthcare systems where you would focus on helping people staying healthy. And we all agree on that. But what we know is that the so-called lifestyle diseases can be managed effectively through preventive approaches, behavioral intervention, as well as appropriate medical intervention when it's needed. And yet, even after decades of effective treatments, an increased attention on the importance of healthy lifestyle choices, today more than 21 million people are still dying prematurely from the consequence of cardiometabolic conditions such as heart attack, stroke, or diabetic decompensation. This is the first cause of premature mortality. And that's incredible because, as I said, the condition to actually treat and manage properly those conditions exist. And COVID-19 was, if you want, a put in the forefront this underlying condition of our population. Because, as you know, having underlying conditions as cardiometabolic can increase the risk of likely to suffer severe consequences from COVID-19. So he brought that to the forefront. Outside of the pandemic, those burden of those chronic conditions weighed heavily on our healthcare system. Just as an example, diabetic affect 463 million adults worldwide, and it will account for $760 billion, or roughly 10% of the global health expenditure. So clearly, and it's still growing. As we speak, the growth is actually double digits. So there is an expansion of those conditions despite the fact that we can address them. And they were, as I said, brought to the forefront with the pandemic. So to me, the pandemic of COVID-19 forced us to rethink how to reverse the course of such chronic condition. And it has become clear that simply managing them is no longer enough. How should we do? I think one avenue that has the biggest potential to me is by fully embracing the potential of data. And this leads to actually to my second point, which is how do we accelerate the adoption of digital technology and data integration to manage those conditions? COVID-19 has shown us the important role of data and technology in so many fronts in healthcare. It has accelerated the adoption of telemedicine as an essential way to engage with health system and providing support to patients. No longer that actually this weekend, I was looking at the latest data on telemedicines around different continents, and it was really striking. In the US, at the as we enter in the pandemic, we only had about a few percentage point of interaction between patient and doctors done through telemedicine. I think it was around 2%. Now it's around 20%. It rose to 20% quite quickly, and it's now stable for 20%. That will transform radically the way this interaction can be improved between patient and physician. Data and technology were critical in shaping our response to COVID-19, from helping us understand the speed of evolution of the virus to searching for cures and implement measures to stop the virus on its track. We need to embrace the power of data and technology if we want to help build a more effective response to healthcare challenges, such as what I said at the beginning, which is this cardiometabolic chronic diseases. We know the benefit of managing chronic disease effectively. I mean, if we were to apply the guidelines, okay, and treat those population, we know the incredible effect we will have on the lives of millions of people. Yet, despite the innovative and the effective treatment, these diseases remain mainly uncontrolled. Data integration, leveraging real-world evidence, will allow healthcare system to be much more effective in their management of chronic condition, because we will be in position to identify the population at most risk. Primary prevention that actually affect all population is very hard to force adherence. But when you really target the at-risk, leveraging real-world evidence, and you can also help clinicians understand in their population what could be the projection with predictive model of the treatment at guidelines, you can really see a very different behavior of both parties. Together with solutions beyond medicine, meaning integrated care, where the Internet of Things or connected devices are brought to the patient, we can also increase patient adherence and improve their outcome at the end of the day. So we need to collectively continue to push for wider adoption of more efficient use of data and digital technology. It's complex. We know there is a lot of heterogeneity. There is a lot of noise in the data. But of course, we need to continue to work together in ensuring that that data is widely available and the quality of the data is improved, because it will help to increase the connected to increase the connection of the ecosystem and increase the outcome. The third point that I wanted to bring to the discussion of the round table is how we'll build a cross-sector approach to stimulate investment and resources behind innovative approaches. This transformation can only happen if all parts of the system work together toward the same goal. We must build sustained global and cross-sector collaboration. Over the past months, we saw exceptional partnership rising that would have not been even conceivable a few months ago, just like our collaboration with the GSK or the US BARDA on our recombinant protein-based COVID-19 vaccine. The crisis has demonstrated the importance of joining our forces to tackle COVID-19, bringing together our resources and expertise across all sectors. I'd like to mention two that I believe are transformative development triggered by the pandemics. The one that comes is, of course, the COVAX facility coded by Gavi, CEPI, and WHO, in which Sanofi and GSK intend to make 200 million doses of our adjuvant recombinant protein-based COVID-19 vaccine once it's available and when it's approved by regulatory authorities. The second one is, of course, around this intention to create the European BARDA. I just heard, actually, this morning, the name, which is HERA, which is the Health Emergency Response Authority, announced by the European Commission President. Policymakers, academic, civil society, industry colleagues are coming together, taking the learning from the COVID-19 to ensure that we are not caught off guard by the next pandemic, and then we can work together in a more effective way. But to conclude, I would like to say that we can already learn one thing from this current pandemic, which is when all stakeholders actively work together behind a single critical goal, we increase our chance of finding solution. And has been very evident for me during the COVID-19, even in the most difficult challenges where we were all locked down and communication was complex. The crisis is starting to show the potential of a more robust, prioritized healthcare system, one that can move effectively, help prevent disease and avoid a much larger portion of the current healthcare cost burden in critical hospitalization and long-term care, where actually prevention could actually work in avoiding those costs so that we can invest this capital in long-term management. There are two key questions for us to keep in mind to ensure that we can create the right level of coordination for this to happen. One is, how do we continue to increase an effective coordination amongst all the players of the healthcare system, and especially between public and private? We said that the European version of BARDA is one, but what else? The second one is, how can we create greater alignment and coordination cross country? That's a complex one, and WHO, of course, is in the core of that. But that's, of course, a key element as we progress. With COVID-19, a number of initiatives have been made possible with incredible speed, public, private, COVAX and others, digital acceleration. Now, we must build on this to continue to work together across public and private sector and across country to create a more sustainable healthcare system. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And thank you for focusing on prevention, data, cross-sectoral collaboration. We will come back to that in the discussion. I suggest that we listen to our four panelists in a row. But of course, the questions that comes immediately to mind for the discussion, and maybe I'd like already to draw ASSI's attention to that point. What does cross-sector collaboration means for governance? How does that translate into governance? ASSI and I have had some very good experience in that regard, but we've also seen some limits to cross-sectoral governance. So, Alexandre, maybe this is a question I'll put to you right when we start the panel. Since this is a key theme of this conference.